we'll start with this. Well, Michaela Mayer had this to say via her Twitter account. She says, I'll be announcing my opponent for June 19th soon as I get the okay. I asked to unify right away, but the promoters could not come to an agreement for whatever reason. Oh. I only have so much power. Hopefully, we can have a 130-pound undisputed champion by the end of this year, though. I'm also 5'9", walking around at 148 pounds. So don't be surprised if I jump up for some fun with the bigger girls while I wait for a deal to be made. And I'm going to be honest, I don't know that Michaela Mayer would go up to 135 pounds for her next fight because there are no titles up there for her to fight for. The biggest name at 135 pounds, Katie Taylor, is set to be facing Natasha Jonias. So that takes Katie out of the equation. Michaela's talking about moving up in weight.
Right.
For a brief excursion, not exactly a title run. That leads me to believe that perhaps she might fight as high as 140 pounds, though not against a world champion, not against Kaylee Reese, not against Mary McGee, not against Christina Lenarditu, and not against Chantal Kimron. I'm thinking that, you know, maybe she fights a former champion like Erika Farias because that's what the rumor seems to be.
The former WBC 140-pound champion.
And I struggle with this rumor, I do, because according to Michaela Mayer, the Nevada State Athletic Commission did not approve Alicia Baumgartner on the premise that her quality of competition just wasn't good enough. Well, Erika Farias has fought better fighters than Alicia Baumgartner, but Erika Farias has been out of action for over a year. That's the first problem. And the second problem is that she's lost her last two fights. Her last two fights were against Jessica McCaskill at 140 pounds, and Jessica beat her both times. So what are we to believe? That the Nevada State Athletic Commission would not approve a fighter coming off of consecutive victories, but they'd approve a fighter coming off of consecutive losses.
I mean, they've both been out of action for over a year.
But one fighter is coming off of consecutive victories, three of them, and one fighter is coming off of consecutive losses, two of them. You know, 2 months ago, we ran a story here on the channel involving Erika Farias and what was supposed to be a fight with Lescano at 140 pounds. That was supposed to be Erika Farias' first fight under the Chino Maidana banner, the promotional banner. And for whatever reason, that fight didn't happen. It
was supposed to take place on April 9th.
And I guess things just fell apart. The fight didn't actually take place. So that's essentially saying that Erika, if this rumor checks out, would be walking into this fight with Michaela, coming off of two consecutive losses and over a year of inactivity. Now you tell me, which commission is going to approve that? Surely not the one that just rejected Alicia Baumgartner as an opponent.
Not the same one that just did that.
In any event, I don't know how true this rumor is or isn't, though that does seem to be the prevailing theory, that Michaela Mayer's next opponent is going to be former WBC 140-pound champion Erika Farias, and we'll see if that rumor checks out, though even if it does, there are going to be a lot of people that look at this under a magnifying glass because Erika hasn't fought in over a year and she's coming off of two consecutive losses. You walked away from Hamadouche and Baumgartner for this? I'm going to give it to you straight because it's the only way I know how to give it to you. I don't know how hard the people over there at Top Rank are working for the best interests of Michaela Mayer. You know, I'm not in the business of apologizing for what decisions are made on a fighter's behalf. Now, I'm not trying to apologize for Michaela, but I can't help but think that the people over there at Top Rank aren't doing what they need to do to get her where she needs to be. And where she needs to be is in unification matches. There is a champion at 130 pounds that does not have a dance partner. The Terry Harper versus Hyun Mi Choi fight has been officially announced. But Mai Bahamadouche, she ain't got nobody to fight with, and it just looks a certain way.
And Steffi Bull, you know, he told me this would happen.
They think that she doesn't want the Hamadouche fight. They think that she's afraid of Hamadouche.
She won't fight Hamadouche. I would happily ask Eddie to put it in a contract. Let's do a four-person tournament. Do something with Top Rank. All the four, Terry's agreed terms for Choi. Them two fight. You're in the winner's fight. We could have undisputed win two fights, but it won't happen.
In super middleweight news, Lopez versus Kambosos, Cruz Dezern versus Cedar Ruiz, undisputed title fight in play for Triller Event. That's right, folks. The people over there at Triller are in the process of bringing this fight into fruition, set to go down on the undercard of Lopez versus Kambosos Jr. And If it happens that way, I'm buying the fight.
Yeah.
I am.
Yeah.
I guess that French on Cruz's presence the night of the Ben Askren versus Jake Paul fight, she wasn't just there for the festivities. She was there doing business.
You know, I talked about this in passing, how it surprised me that Oscar's ring return wasn't set to go down on DAZN. It would be happening on the Triller platform, and how that might service as a segue for several of his other fighters to follow him over to Triller, since the relationship with DAZN...
Now the Golden Boy ain't got Canelo anymore.
The relationship might be strained.
In the article, it talks about them potentially making Cruz DAZN versus Cedar Ruiz as an undercard fight for Lopez versus Kambosos. The article also talks about Zerto Ramirez perhaps getting a slot. Zerto, who just signed to Golden Boy Promotions. This would be his first fight as a Golden Boy Promotions fighter, though I don't know if this qualifies as a Golden Boy Promotions event, as a Golden Boy Promotions card, lest we forget. Teofimo Lopez is the main event of this card, and he's still under contract with Top Rank. Better still, this is a scenario that I discussed here on the channel in a previous video that you never know. The news in boxing is fluid and ever-changing. And what all of this could herald is Golden Boy Promotions migration from DAZN over to Triller. That's right, you have to entertain that possibility. The good news here is that the people over there at Triller have the kind of finances to make things happen. I mean, we see how they intervened in the Teofimo Lopez versus George Kambosos purse bid. We see what role they had to play in all of that, and I fucking told you guys, they're not gonna stop there. Their interest in the sport of boxing doesn't seem to be limited to staging novelty fights between YouTubers and mixed martial artists. They seem to want to have a lasting stay in the sport. They seem to want to make an impression.
And maybe that's not a bad thing.
Not a bad thing for me and you, anyways. Maybe it's a bad thing for the promoters, as things could get that much more competitive in the American market. Maybe that puts more pressure on the other promotional outfits that are out there to make quality matches, since now they have a new competitor to compete with. But for me and you, for us, the fight fans, well, that's a good thing. That means more quality content wherever you look. If they can put this fight together, that's a very encouraging omen.
But let's not get ahead of ourselves.
Let's wait until this news is made official before we get the confetti out. In other news, just as fast as we talked about this story, that's about as fast as it took to debunk it. Apparently, Jermall Charlo has now clarified that Mark Breland is not actually training him and left a message for Deontay Wilder. Mark Breland is not training me. He's very close friends with my trainer. We laughing, all this hate coming in. Been knowing Coach Breland since I was 10 years old at Bronze Bomber. Don't feed into the BS. There are those interpreting this as a sign of weakness from Jermall Charlo, that maybe he was considering taking on Mark Breland, but due to the backlash that news received, he's decided to go the other way. I've seen those kinds of sentiments expressed. In truth, I think that this is just a byproduct of the times. An image of Mark Breland with Jermall Charlo and Ronnie Shields was posted by Jermall Charlo himself, and you know, the news people, they chose to run with it. They chose to report that as you know, Jermall Charlo hiring Mark Breland. I myself saw no statements from Jermall himself or Ronnie Shields indicating that that's what the case, but that's how the story was reported, thus that's the impression it left on me and you.
And I gave it a day to marinate.
I didn't rush to react to the news like some others. I gave it some time to marinate, but in that time it seems that that story was proven to be no story at all. Though I myself have to admit that I spoke prematurely, because this news broke sometime late yesterday, and here today it was debunked. Debunked as no news at all, and that time spent reacting to that pseudo-news could have been spent discussing something more tangible.
It's just a sign of the times, man.
There are so many pundits out there looking to break the next news, break the next big story, and this would be a story of some significance, as Mark Breland was sacked by Deontay Wilder, who believes that Mark was his saboteur in the Tyson Fury fight. So what kind of statement would that send to Deontay Wilder if his PBC stablemate, Jermall Charlo, decided to take him on where Wilder doesn't trust him to be in his corner?
It really doesn't matter now, because that's not the case.
That's really not a good look for Mike Kopinger, who tweeted about the story, the same Mike Kopinger who was at odds late yesterday with Leonard Smellerby
over a separate story that he ran in reference to PBC's
split
relationship with Fox and how that relationship is set to come to a screeching halt, come to a close. Leonard accused Mike of spreading misinformation, and you have to wonder now if Leonard isn't onto something. I mean, I really don't know. I actually think Mike is on the money when it comes to that Fox story, but this, well, you know, it's just not a good look.
So, Charlo didn't hire Mark Breland.
That's the new news. And just in keeping with the theme of news coming by way of Mike Kopinger, you know, he says it's reported that the June 5th date was tentative, and already TMZ is claiming that now June 6th, a Sunday, is being targeted for Mayweather versus Logan Paul in Miami, Teofimo Lopez versus George Kambosos, also in South Florida, so we could avoid competing pay-per-views and have two Miami area shows in one weekend. I don't know if this story is going to check out or if it's going to fizzle out the way that Charlo story we just talked about fizzled out. Though, if the story checks out, if the story sticks, it's a rather shrewd move from the Mayweather people moving the date from the 5th to the 6th as to not compete with yet another pay-per-view happening that same night. You know, this ain't Mayweather versus Marcos Maidan.
Nope.
This ain't Mayweather versus Cotto, Mayweather versus Canelo, Mayweather versus Pacquiao. This ain't none of that. This ain't even Mayweather versus McGregor. This is Mayweather versus a YouTuber. And the selling point that Floyd Mayweather Jr. used to employ to sell fights doesn't apply here because Floyd was the guy that a lot of people loved to hate. Granted, he had fans. I was one among them. But there were other people who bought his fights for the sole purpose of watching him lose. And that never happened. That mirage, that illusion, helped sell a lot of fights. That illusion is not in play here when he's squaring off against the YouTuber, of all things, in the ring. You can't use that as a selling point because we know Logan Paul. He's no boxer.
What kind of odds are you supposed to give him to win the fight?
I understood the Maymack crossover match. There was just too much money on the table to pass up. I even understood the Tenshin Nuksukao fight to some degree. If they're willing to pay you that much money to fight this little guy, why the fuck not? You're a retired fighter.
But who says because you're a retired fighter, you can't make yourself a couple of bucks? If the people over there at Rizin are willing to give you a multi-million dollar payday to fight this little guy, why the fuck not?
I understood those things, I did.
Admittedly, I understood Maymack more than I understood that Tenshin Nuksukao situation, though all the same, there was a similar thought process, similar logic in play here against Logan Paul. Years after those novelty fights took place, I can't say wholeheartedly that I understand what's happening here, as this excursion, this endeavor, is indicative of something else entirely. I mean, who the fuck does Floyd Mayweather think is interested in seeing him share the ring in an exhibition match, not even a real fight, but an exhibition match that has no outcome against a YouTuber?
Must be Logan Paul's fans.
Not Floyd's. Whatever fans Floyd Mayweather amassed throughout his years as a professional boxer, those are fans of the sport of boxing, you understand? They want to see a boxing match. And sharing the ring with Logan Paul doesn't qualify. I imagine that this endeavor is a tough sell. It's a tough sell all around. Even Floyd's biggest sycophants have to be looking at this and asking themselves, why the fuck would I want to watch this? The whole appeal of watching Floyd Mayweather Jr. in action breaks down two ways. You either want to see this guy lose, or you actually take pleasure in watching the man work. Watching the man work against professional boxers like himself. Seasoned champions, experienced fighters, but not YouTubers.
Come on.
I mean, I myself am a Floyd Mayweather Jr. fan, and I gotta tell you, if these two cards, hypothetically speaking, were happening on the same night, and I had to choose between the Lopez versus Kambosos Jr. card and the Mayweather-Paul card, the Lopez versus Kambosos Jr. card would get my money, especially now that the people over there at Triller mean to stage the undisputed super middleweight title fight between Franchon Cruz and Aline Cedarouz. That gives me, a boxing fan, that much more incentive to purchase that card as opposed to wasting any of my hard-earned dollars on Floyd Mayweather Jr. versus a YouTuber.
What's the fucking sense in that?
I don't know how true this story is. Don't know if it's gonna pan out, though it wouldn't surprise me if it did, because I reiterate, who do they expect to be interested in this card? How exactly are you supposed to decorate it when this is the main event?
And the most concise sentiment that I can express in association with this story, and whether or not it pans out, is my, how the mighty have fallen. How the biggest draw that pay-per-view market has ever seen has been reduced to locking horns with a YouTuber and having to move the date so that he doesn't have to compete with anybody.
It's embarrassing.
And it's embarrassing because it seems like Floyd is trying to stay relevant by riding someone else's wave. I mean, this isn't his own wave that he'd be riding, you understand. Floyd Mayweather Jr. and what fans he amassed as a boxer. Thus, those are boxing fans that want to see a boxing match. Mayweather versus Paul doesn't qualify as that. So if you're hoping to cash in on something here, it would have to be Logan Paul's fans, because boxing fans don't want to see this. Maybe his fans do, but fans of the sport don't.
Though, once again, I don't know if this story's going to check out.
How much are you supposed to justify in the name of a payday when you're the guy who's already had the biggest paydays the sport has ever seen? You know? The highest earning boxer in the history of boxers, who went as far as fighting a mixed martial artist for an obscene amount of money, made more money, not as much, fighting a very small kickboxer several years ago, and now you're reduced to fighting YouTubers? I mean, what's actually going on here?
How many times is a payday supposed to be a justification?
Yeah, we've been seeing Floyd Mayweather a lot more these last couple of weeks, last couple of months. And, you know, he's growing his hair, he's growing a beard. You wonder that the guy's not going through a midlife crisis, because he might be.
Strange time in Mayweather's life, maybe?
He certainly looks strange with that beard, in a nutshell. There's not much reason for a guy like me to purchase Floyd Mayweather Jr. versus Logan Paul. That card has absolutely no appeal to me as a boxing fan whatsoever. And I'm a guy who, in the past, in Floyd's heyday, spent quite a few dollars on Floyd's pay-per-views. But not this time. So either way, whether it goes down on the 5th or they move it to the 6th. In any event, they're not getting my fucking money.